viewers, this is Manoj Agarwal from Banking Frontiers. I am today going to get into a conversation with three people from the financial sector, and we are going to talk about how to onboard customers who are less tech savvy, who are less educated into the digital ecosystem. After the lockdown, it is clear that the digital ecosystem is the way to do business, to engage with customers, to engage with suppliers. And in general, digital is it. And obviously, it is a challenge to onboard the less tech-savvy customers and the less literate customers onto these digital channels and options. So today, I have with me Mr. Vivek Chaturvedi, Mr. Anuj Pandey, and Mr. Manoj Kumar Sahani. And we will be discussing with these experts how digital onboarding and engagement with these kind of customers will this could be done in the coming days and months. So gentlemen, welcome to Banking Frontiers. Welcome to this web panel discussion.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. So my first question is that, you know, it is obviously difficult to bring the less tech savvy and the less educated, the less literate customers onto this digital channels. But I'm sure that over the years, including this lockdown, including demonetization during other periods, there would have been some instances where you have seen some successes beyond the normal success. Can we start with one or two stories on such successes and try to get insights from them and then get on to more detailed discussions? Any one of you would like to share?
So I'll start. Before that, I'll just give a brief introduction about YouGrow Capital. So the premise with which we started to look at the credit gap issue with small businesses via the lens of a technology and analytics. So we were trying to do something which has happened to some extent in consumer lending, but in lending it has not happened before. So we started with this premise that we will digitize and digitalize both together, so that this problem of tech savviness plus logistical hassles can solve together.
So
the example I wanted to quote was how we completely digitized the sourcing via intermediary in small businesses lending. And the whole idea was, so typically when a customer applies, small businesses apply for a loan, they apply with ethics and they are balance sheets, there are P&L statements, there are bank statements, etc. And people over the years are used to that physical touch and feel of that file. What we attempted, we developed a software platform to a scan of all this, digitize it at the source itself, and then back to our rule engine so that the decision making becomes instantaneous. And this required lot of solving of smaller problems. So the way we approached this problem was to break it down. And that is where, eventually my message and learning is that it's a huge problem. And it relates to mindset, it relates to technology capabilities, and it relates to integrating all of it together. And one has to resolve it step by step to achieve success. From tech savviness perspective, it is now clear that anyone who can operate a smartphone is he knows enough how to do digital transactions. Then it is only becomes a question of how easy it is in his mind and how it is easy it is in his fingertips to go about it. We are in small businesses lending, and there the added problem or added complication is that the whole ecosystem has to be digitally enabled for the small businesses to carry on. So typically a small business will have his P&L and balance sheet filed by a CA who sits somewhere else. And in his day-to-day life, whenever a requirement of a financial document is there, he just picks up the call to CA and says, "Ye jama kara dena." Now this transformation of this to someone who is uploading his own balance sheet on his mobile phone is something which is more of a mindset than a technology technical know-how. And this is the process we all can help if it we make it easy and we are able to give a decision where his patience doesn't run out. And this is what we have tried. So I was giving example on how we have tried to approach this problem at an intermediary level first, because small businesses, the way they do business is they are dependent on other people for their financial services need. And if we have to, if we have to go and give a digital solution to them, then we also have to educate their partners in this journey. And the attempt which we have made on intermediaries through our proprietary software platform is something which I wanted to talk about. And directionally, it has been a big success. The learning has been that it has to be, it has to make sense eventually. A clear benefit of moving to digital versus physical. And a decision making in reasonable amount of time, the quality of decision and overall handling ease is what is going to, you know, tell them and make them loyal to this.
So Anuj, if I may just ask at this point, how long is this journey for a typical customer to become digitally savvy with your set of solutions and channels?
So overall, from the perspective of the time it takes to completely incubate and for them to be comfortable with this kind of an environment, it takes is one successful transaction. The proof that whatever was promised gets actually delivered, then the customer really migrates.
Okay.
But a lot of time it may happen that during that process, he might face a little bit of technical difficulty. And at that point in time, you are there to handhold him. It goes a long way.
Okay.
So just to give an example, we've completed a year. And during COVID, we contacted customers for a survey. And a lot of those survey questions were via a link on their mobile phone. And
okay.
Most of the people were very okay, were quite comfortable answering them. So this journey we have seen personally of how people evolve.
Okay. That's interesting. Yeah. Vivek, if I may come to you, your company's name itself is Digit. So obviously digital is the essence for your organization. What has been the journey to enrolling the non-tech savvy customers?
So I'll just add on what Anuj was saying, and I will also talk about our journey. So he talked about mindset. He talked about making it simple. So when we started with this. We didn't start with Digit as the name. The name of the company was Open. It was made Digit because we thought that if the name is not simple enough, then whatever we do will not be simple. What he talked about, how do you make it simple, and how do you then ensure that it's in the customer's mind also, that he should also think that it's simple. That is one of the big challenge. When we think in three things. One is accessibility. So if you have to bring consumers who are non-tech savvy, and when you think about non-tech savvy, people have like a very different mindset, but like they're like people in our houses are also non-tech savvy. So when I think about non-tech savvy, it's my parents also. It could be a cousin staying in some other place who may be also not comfortable with the tech that is there right now, and also the kind of products that financial services offer. But one of the big success stories, if you see, is all the wallets. Right? 6 years, 7 years down the line, nobody would have thought that you will go to a vegetable shop and then you will see a barcode. And you will be able to pay through a barcode. And that is not going to be one barcode. The person will have like 5 barcode and he will say, I have accounts in all these things. Aapko jo chahiye, aap usme pay kar do. It's one of the big success stories is that. Second success story is actually, if I see, is the previous organization I come from. I come from e-commerce. And 10 years down the line, e-commerce was small. Not too many takers were there. The biggest problem was security and trust. Mm-hmm. And then, cash on delivery came and the people started experiencing it. And what Anuj talked about, it's about the first transaction. you do a first transaction, you do a second transaction, then you see the convenience, you see the benefit and convenience versus, you know, the initial inertia you have, and suddenly it becomes a part of the life. And the same thing we have also done. So in case insurance, the biggest thing happens, and insurance, I think it happens with a larger audience because nobody understands what insurance is. Nobody understand what products are sold. So for what we have seen is that starting from what you are selling, how do you ensure that that is simple and that is understandable so that customer does not have apprehension before buying? It starts from there. Then the second thing is how do you make it understandable? So one is the simplicity that comes internally, where you have structured your products and made it simple. Second is how do you communicate that simplicity? How do you change the mindset? So in our case, small acts like all our documents are actually verified and written by 15-year-old kids. So that one, it actually physically makes all the documents simple to understand. But when you tell the customer also that, hey, this document is actually approved by a 15-year-old, it is written by a 15-year-old, a mindset is also that, okay, I will be able to understand if I read this document. So one is what you drive internally in the organization, but also the kind of acts that you have. One of the acts that we had, we launched for all our customers 6 months back was a simple board game. And if you play that board game, you will actually understand the importance of insurance. Now, the idea is that all these simple acts can help in changing mindset. Some of the agents that we have, especially in tier two towns, they usually use Excels, and they are like habitual of using Excels versus logging into a portal. Each portal is different. Each company's portal is different. So Excel is like one standard in structured document, and they know that, okay, I know how to do plus minus addition or do some policy data in an Excel. Now, for us, and when we started thinking was that how do we bring that kind of familiarity in whatever we do? So if a person is habitual of using an Excel or a tabular form, how do we ensure that the interface that he uses, that interface actually looks like that, so that the initial apprehension is not there? And what Anu said was very important. It's all about initial apprehension. It also happened when we started driving. Like the first 2-3 time when we started driving, it seemed like we will never be able to drive a car. But then suddenly after 2-3 times, now you drive, and there are like a lot of people who drive while talking to a lot of people also. So it's all about initial apprehension or inertia. What we have seen is that whatever is the behavior of the customer, what he is doing right now, if you bring that if that becomes the bridge to do a new things, it is easier for the customer. So somebody is habitual of taking photographs. Now, if you have a process which actually requires taking photographs, the initial inertia goes down. So that also becomes one big piece in our strategy, that how do we learn what people are already doing? And then whether it's a agent, whether it's a customer, whoever, whether he's tech savvy, whether he comes from a tier one market or tier two markets, if somebody is interacting with certain interfaces, if somebody is has a way of working, how do we ensure that the new process is part of that behavior? And like in marketing also, the biggest thing to change is somebody's behavior. So the idea is that how do we ensure that the current behaviors becomes the bridge for somebody to cross over and start doing other things also. The third thing that becomes important in certain cases is affordability. Now, if you see a vendor who has a simple barcode and he is digital savvy, he can take all the payments from the customers because there is no investment involved. The person already has a phone. Opening up a account is very easy. It is predominant. It is in their native language, so vernacular flows are used. Once it is, they get all the update in a very intuitive way. The way you use WhatsApp, it's basically using a wallet, is pretty similar to how you use a WhatsApp or some of those channels. So other thing becomes is affordability. How you reduce initial investment, how you reduce initial learning curve. And in case if somebody is buying, then also things like, you know, if somebody is happy to pay in cash, can you have a cash on delivery? Or the customer can go and deliver cash. versus asking him on the first transaction that, hey, I need you to pay via net banking or a credit card. Maybe on the third transaction, fourth transaction, when he is habitual of the rest of the things, that jump can happen. But expecting the customer to go through the entire process with a completely different behavior, completely different journey becomes tricky. So the idea is, how do you break it down and how do you have a strategy where you say, okay, first thing, I want the customer to do this. Then I want to move to the next step, then on to the next step. And by the time he has done 5-6 transactions, he's actually onboarded into the entire journey.
So I have one follow-on question for Vivek. Any examples of customer segments, maybe geographical or age-wise or education-wise, that really surprised you with very quick adoption of digital channels in the last 12 months?
I will give you two examples. Mohan, you are saying something.
Yeah, I was just saying that, you know, just to give the banking perspective here, you know, in banking, you know, there's a lot of, you know, challenges which we face, you know, while onboarding a non-tech savvy guy, less literate customers. So there's, you know, a whole lot of, you know, barriers which which are there. For example, there's a lot of trust factor because the money is being dealt with. So there are security concerns. Then, you know, in non-tech savvy guys are probably mostly businessmen, lalas, and probably, you know, small shopkeepers. They have a habit of dealing more in cash. So getting them onboarded on digital platforms is really challenging because they have a habit of dealing, you know, mostly in cash. Now, if we look at, all these barriers, these barriers have been really, really removed, you know, by, you know, introducing digital payments. If you look at the recent digital payment service providers in terms of, you know, UPI, Aadhaar-enabled payment systems, and, you know, Google Pay, Phone Pay, all these, you know, UPI applications have played a major role in transforming the entire, you know, the payment space altogether. If you look at, you know, this has happened. Why? Just because of few reasons. Just to name them, the one is convenience. If a customer is finding convenience, he is ready to pay, he is ready to do a transactions because there is just a click of a button and the money is sent. Then this saves actually a lot of time for the customers. They don't have to go to banks for, you know, standing up in the queues, withdrawing money, depositing money. They don't have to go for, you know, all other kind of, you know, efforts need not require to go to bank and do the transactions. So the moment they understand the power of this digital banking, it becomes really, you know, easy for the customers to onboard it. So for Utkarsh Small Finance Bank, what we did since the launch of the bank, it was launched in 2017. Since the launch of the bank, we have introduced all the digital applications for our customers, be it internet banking, mobile banking, you know, customer CRM modules. We have, CBS, that is centralized banking systems. So all these digital applications has played a major role in bringing ease of banking in the daily banking needs of the consumers.
So Mohan, what kind of customer segments did you find actually onboarding to the digital ecosystem more quickly than expected? There was something that was attractive for them,
but was not
initially known to the bank.
Yeah. So, we have seen the big jump in the registrations in customers' registration doing, you know, digital banking registrations in terms of this has happened during mid March and till date it is on a very, very high rise. Because it's almost 300% jump we have seen in customers registering on the digital banking side. And if you look at customer segments, majorly urban, metro, consumers do register, but we have a major chunk of customers who are registering now in these, you know, areas from UP and Bihar as well. So urban and rural, both segments are evolving, but they are evolving. Rural is evolving, but urban is anyhow, they are, mostly using the digital banking applications. So because of this COVID, pandemic attack and the lockdown situation, this has actually, we as a bank have seen a lot of, customers registering online, and they are moving to the digital transactions. Yeah.
Vivek, what has been your experience, unexpected experience with some customer segments? You're giving two examples.
I'll give you two examples. One is from the e-commerce world. When I joined e-commerce company in, I think, 2011-2012, metros used to contribute almost 70%, 80% of the business. By the time I moved out, metros contribution was less than 15%. And all those smaller towns with in Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh, Bihar, they were contributing like 0.5%, 1%. And what happened was that because of internet, no matter whether you're tech savvy or not, even if you are on WhatsApp, you are aware of what is happening. And there is a trend that happened, and we did a lot of research also on that, that even somebody who is not tech savvy, it's an aspiration for him to understand, what is happening in the market. What are the current trends? In different industries also, whether it's fashion, whether it's technology, people want to know. And because the information is available to everyone, everybody is, the information gap is less, and everybody wants to aspire to that. So the idea of cost cash on delivery was like that idea. Basically, it just moved the entire e-commerce space, which was basically concentrated in metros to people who were comfortable using credit card, debit cards, and net banking. Suddenly, it just expanded, and then suddenly we saw, like, within 3 years, the entire landscape changed. Second thing that we are seeing is, which is happening in insurance also, we started experimenting with a lot of commercial guys, where basically people are auto drivers, truck drivers, in terms of how they will respond to a technology driven platform versus a typically if the perception is that there is an auto driver or a truck driver, chances are that all the insurance needs would be fulfilled by an agent, and they will predominantly go there and do it. One of the things that, and we also thought that initially that, they will have their respective agents that, I go to this person and I do this thing. But what we have started seeing is that a lot of searches are happening on Google now. And a lot of people are actually going there and started searching. And most of them are vernacular searches, which is happening done by auto rickshaw guys, which are done by your truck driver guys, where they are going online. What Anuj briefly talked about, people have heard about it. People have heard about, you go online, you can choose the product that you want. The other thing is people also know that, being online is also aspirational. Others are doing it. I also want to do it. So there is this, there is a trend which is going on where people are going out. Another trend that we saw was when the Motor Vehicle Act was introduced in September, suddenly vernacular searches for bike insurance went up in smaller markets. So customers who like bike ownership is quite large in smaller markets, and there again people are going, but people are using vernacular searches versus the English searches.
Those are interesting examples. Thank you, Vivek. Thank you, Anuj. The next kind of question I have in mind is, obviously these people need to be reached out to a lot, and there are two ways to do it. One is through mass communication, where the same message goes across. Another is customized communication. One thing for a truck driver, another thing for a rickshaw driver, a third thing for an SME in a rural area, maybe a fourth thing for an SME in an urban area, those kind of things. So what has been the response for such communication projects, communication campaigns, both the mass type and the narrowly focused types?
So I'll share my experience. But before that, just to continue on a little on Vivek's point, a minute on that. So a lot of times this happens that just because a solution is being offered digitally, it doesn't mean that it is the best solution for the customer. And lot of times we are under this impression and in this digital transformation that anything which is digital will work. There is no running away from the fact that there's a lot of hard work involved to understand the customer and meet his needs. Now that once you do that, then it is a question of whether you want to execute, administer it digitally or not. You can't even, so you will never be able to sell a second grade product digitally. You can fool people once, but not, but there won't be any repeat transactions. So I just wanted to build on what you asked. In YouGroup, we had this insight, and we are working on this insight that if we have to lend to small businesses, we have to look at those small businesses via the lens of the ecosystem in which it operates. And for small businesses, the ecosystem primarily means the sectors in which we operate. So we chose 8 sectors, and we lend to customers only in these 8 sectors. So there 3 are service oriented: education, healthcare, and hospitality, which is basically chemicals, food processing, light engineering, auto components, etc. What our experience has been in to digitally reach out these customers, the more customized you are in terms of subsector and sector. For example, if healthcare is my sector, and we all give loans to nursing homes, we also give loans to diagnostic laboratories. Other kinds of messages to both. So as much customized you can, you are able to do, it makes more sense. And the click messages are relevant to people, then the click rates are much higher. Very, very clear evidence which we have in last 1 year. So if it's an awareness campaign, and depends on campaign to campaign, if it's an awareness campaign about an entity, then a mass campaign might work. Or maybe in consumer lending, Vivek and the other panelists might will throw light on them. Yeah, I was just saying that in our kind of lending, which is small businesses lending, there is the whole sector is so heterogeneous.
Did you do some campaign during for COVID related?
Yes. We have been doing. And prior to that, also we did a direct to customer beta pilot with us, and the click rates and the response quality and quantity both is much different if the message itself is customized. So when I'm targeting pharmacies versus I am targeting a auto component dealer, the messaging is very different. So it should relate to the customer. The other experience is that they would like to, so they as a consumer, they are used to Facebook now and WhatsApp. So they are used to chatting. So if a business transaction is also in form of chatting through chat boxes, the engagement levels are much higher. Rather than, you know, a plain boring form people have to open and submit, versus that, if you convert those form into interesting set of questions, like a question answer chat, then the completion rates are much higher.
Got it. Understood. That's interesting. Vivek, since yours is more of a mass market, do you have a difference, balance between mass and narrow messaging?
So, Manoj, we have been in business for 3 years, but the business is doing pretty well. But we have not ventured in mass marketing yet. The way we do it, so there are 2 things for us. One is our agents become important. And what happens in insurance, that a lot of the processes which are agent driven, those have a lot of manual interventions. And similarly, some of the processes which are required from a customer perspective, also a lot of the time the paperwork is required or something manual is required. Our thought is that how can everything be thought from a digital lens? So what Anuj said, that everybody is comfortable taking on WhatsApp and everybody is comfortable in taking photos. So any process which requires any document, can it be just a photo taken on a web app or on a WhatsApp? So we have gone this way, where we have basically thought that any process which requires any paperwork, how do we make it digital? And this works for even for onboarding in our scenario. And this onboarding is for everyone, whether it's an agent onboarding or a customer onboarding. Everything is online. It also involves that whenever the claims needs to be paid, it is completely online. So that one piece that comes out is that how do we ensure that there aren't too many manual interventions. Second is how do we make it relevant? Vernacular becomes one more important thing. Even both in onboarding part, when an agent is working on our channels, or also when somebody is going through any process also, we understand that, you know, what kind of language the person will prefer and how do we customize that. During the onboarding, we have seen that people are interested coming online. Now, they will come online and they will again go back and buy from the normal channel. But the whole idea of reading online, or basically just skimming through online and then going and buying preferred network, it still happens a lot. So when the person lands on your platform, how do you engage him and how do you reduce the initial inertia? That also becomes far more important for us. So there is a lot of help content. What we are seeing is video help content makes more sense when somebody is on a mobile. If it is like a 15 minutes, 30 minutes video content, then nobody is going to view it. So it has to be bite-sized. The second is when somebody has landed and somebody has shown interest, then also how do you engage that person? So the first time he's not going to purchase. This we are seeing it with when people come to become agents also. So there also the idea is that people are there on WhatsApp. Like 90% of the people are on WhatsApp. How do you engage them on WhatsApp through giving them bite-sized content in their language? So that also becomes important. And then once the person is ready, then you ensure that the entire journey is also customized for the person.
So interesting thing that I'm getting from you is that rather than the traditional marketing thinking of communicating and sending out messages, you have all kinds of videos and bites and out there, and people can, potential customers can pick up what they like.
Yeah, so our thinking and it depends upon different verticals also. We are not an impulse category. In an impulse category, you need to have mass marketing strategy because you don't know when the customer is ready to buy and then customer comes and buys it. In our scenario, I always tell everyone that insurance is boring. Nobody wakes up in the morning and says, chalo aaj jaake insurance ki website pe dekhte kya naya aaya. It's not like Myntra that morning mein utke aap just catalog dekhte chale gaye. So anybody who is in market is there in market for a very small span. It could be like for 10 days, it could be 15 days. Now, digitally, there are a lot of signals available where you can identify that so-and-so person is in market right now. So the mass market actually for us is completely off. Now, once you identify the signals that the customer is looking for a product, then you start reaching out to a customer you can call it like a micro-targeting. And you ensure that what Anuj was also saying, that you are relevant. So if that relevancy is a function of a lot of signals. It is from where the customer is coming, what kind of devices he is using, what kind of which part of the country he is coming, what is the product that he is looking now. All those becomes important to target him very narrowly. But for us, mass marketing is something which we have not, we don't see doing it for next few years at least.
Got it. Understood. Mohan, if I may come to you.
Sure.
For Utkarsh Bank, what kind of communication messages on a mass marketing format have worked well? And what kind of communications have worked well better when they're very narrowly focused?
So while analyzing, we need to understand the geographical background of the location where we are focusing our efforts to get the potential results. When we look at mass marketing, there are various benefits in banking, and mass marketing plays a major role, but it's very expensive, very costly. So if you look at the mass marketing effectiveness, it's very difficult to measure. However, in our case, in banking sector, narrow messaging, or you can say one-to-one marketing, plays a major role, and it's very effective media. If you really ask me what kind of messaging is working for us, it is working personalized messages, visual messaging is really working for us. Based on that, we have developed various education programs, branch training modules, as well as, you know, direct campaigns in vernacular languages. It is very, very effective. And even on social media, when we play the campaigns, it is giving us very good results.
I see broadly two kinds of digital channels. One is your mobile app, one or more mobile apps which you may have, which may get functionally more and more powerful and flexible and feature rich. Second is there's a lot of things you can do on WhatsApp and Facebook and other social media channels. So what do you see in the current scenario? So let's say this lockdown is, and the scenario is going to continue for the next 2, 3, 4 months. What do you see as going to be meaningful and more impactful, the social media channels or the mobile app? And then one thing stabilize, what is the roadmap ahead between these two options? Or if there is a third option, then please put it.
So let me start this time first.
Yeah, please.
Sorry, Arun. So basically, I will just try to define the scope. So when we say digital or digital channels, I think a lot of the time when we think digital, we end up thinking digital as a platform. I think in my view, and I think Anuj touched that in the first question also, that it's not about being digital is not having a website, or being digital is not about being on social media. It's about when you're thinking any process in the organization, when the organization thinks how they want to do business and how everything will be structured, how do you think digitally? So even if it is any document which needs to be taken from the customer, any information that needs to be delivered, even whether it's how your backend processes work, everything needs to be thought from a consumer perspective and a digital perspective. Channels are immaterial in short term. Manoj, you're saying something?
I was just saying that let's keep to the customer interface part, and what happens within the organization is obviously much more complicated.
Maybe sure. So basically what I'm saying is that if you say 2 months, 3 months, or this thing, it's always it's a long-term discussion. To be frank, with COVID, we have seen dip in both digital platforms and a normal platform. It's a situation where the customer is postponing its purchases. So that dip is there both. Once the things move up, it will open up. What we are seeing is that there is a preference towards, say, a zero-touch channel where the customer does not have to meet people. But that can happen through any of the channels, as long as the way you have structured your business, that whether a customer can come online, or even customer can do the same thing on a WhatsApp, customer can do the same thing on a telephone call also. So as long as customer does not have to step out, any channel we are seeing is that those channels are far better, far preferred versus any channel where the customer needs to physically meet people.
Anuj, your observations?
So
social media versus apps.
So it is a function of what kind of offerings you are going to the customer. So for example, if I am a bank, I am much better off having an app. And focusing, because I want, and then my thought process is to make that app so much of, with so much of its features that customers keep coming back. But if you are you have a proposition which is more transactional in nature and which is not very frequent, like giving loans. So when we give loans, there is actually not much of a point of, you know, having an app installed, getting YouGrow app installed in customer's mobile phone. So it's a function of what strategy one wants to. There is a very fine line between doing too many notifications. Already, I personally, as a consumer, I experience it, and I'm very cognizant of this, that especially people who are new to this digital environment might get overwhelmed by the kind of notifications now are coming for them to, you know, get onboarded on various kinds of digital platforms. So one should be very careful of that. The idea is to make the customer's life easier and not make it more difficult. So logic says that you need to define it and not go insane in getting communication frequency of communication with the customers. So I don't know whether I have answered you or not, but it is a fine balance. What kind of strategy one wants to adopt, both will work.
Right, I understand. That makes sense. So clearly, banks have different kind of strategies. Insurance would have a different kind of strategy. NBFC would have a different kind of strategy. That makes sense. So if you were to look further into the future, what kind of, one has to really grow the business 10x. One is to keep growing 10-20%, and then the most common strategies would typically continue to evolve, the technologies and strategies and digital approaches. But here is an opportunity, actually, because of such a wholesale transformation happening, that one can even think in terms of growing business 10x in a period of 2-3 years, as opposed to 2x or 3x or something. Do you see digital innovations or digital strategies enabling that? Do you see customers adopting digital on such a large scale that you could actually grow your business 10x in 3 years?
Vivek, you can go ahead.
I started with two examples, and we have seen in two different industries. So we are also hopeful that we will also crack the code. we will. I think in terms of wallets, we have already seen that this has happened. I think we have already touched about what is required. You need to make it accessible. You have to make it affordable, and you need to ensure that the initial mindset that the customer has, that we need to ensure that the inertia is down. If you see simple trends like a Google trend and search for any of the products, in last 2-3 years, the search have tripled, and in some cases it has gone past more than that also, which basically says that people are coming online. If you do a state-wise searches also, you will see a trend that the people are actually from the newer states, people are coming and people are searching. So people are coming online. However, will they buy everything online? If somebody thinks that will happen, is not possible also, because there is again a human touch that people seek, especially in certain categories. Insurance becomes that category where even people have done all the homework, they have understood the product and everything. At the end, because it's the first time they are buying or second time they are buying, it's not a product which is bought at a very high frequency. It's like if you are buying international travel insurance, you buy it once in 3 years, 4 years. If you're buying a car insurance, you buy once in a year. So there is a lot of inertia when you are making the final decision. And that time, people look for a human touch to assure them that the decision that they are making makes sense. So it is going to be a hybrid journey. It is going to be a hybrid journey where either it's online plus you have a assistant on a WhatsApp, or if it's online plus an agent. It is happening in European markets also. In European markets, a lot of people now, especially in insurance, general insurance, wants to come buy online, but they want it to be serviced by an agent or a broker, because at the time of claim, they actually want a human touch and they want to interact with a human. So we are also doing some of those things. One of the things that we started with was that in insurance, people seek human touch. So we will ensure that we will not have IVR. So in our scenario, if the customer calls, there has to be a person who will pick it up within 10-15 seconds while the phone is ringing, and there has to be a human touch to that. Similarly, at the time of buying, if a customer requires assistance, he can just drop a WhatsApp and he will have one person answering all the queries that the person has. The same thing goes to the agents also. Even agents who are earlier who have basically sold insurance in a manual way, where they know that, you know, I can go and submit my cash to a branch. I can submit all the policy document to a branch. Now, suddenly asking them that, hey, you will do everything yourself. Even you can raise claims for your customers. Even if you want to do any endorsements for the customer, you do it. We will give you interfaces and you will be able to do it. Now, they are also, while the process is same, it's just that instead of somebody else is doing it, now you are asking the agent to do it. There is a lot of inertia. Now, for that also, we follow the same strategy that for our agent, we have a customer, we have a 24/7 call center available where they can call and they can talk to a person. For the agents also, the same thing is available. The 24/7, they can drop a query, they can call us, they can ping us on WhatsApp, and somebody will help them out. And the thing that happens is that once the person does it three times, four times, five times, then you can basically let him go and then he is self-sufficient. But yeah, initial 5-6 transactions, you have to handhold the person.
So essentially what you're saying that is removing the friction, whatever type of friction is there, in the customer journey, customer acquisition and doing the transaction, those have to be removed to see growth and scalability in the business.
Actually, another thing that I was saying was that one is you have to remove friction, but second thing is when the customer is taking first step, you need to give him comfort that there is somebody to hold you if something goes bad.
Correct. I thought that also sounded like friction, but fair enough. Understood.
Yeah. And that can happen online also. That can happen over a WhatsApp. So you don't have to have like a physical person available. That can happen digitally.
So if you can just tell me, what is the discussion right now going on which particular point?
So right now we are discussing how is it possible to grow business 10x mm-hmm. using some kind of digital strategy mm-hmm. because India is starved for credit, India is starved for insurance. I mean, insurance penetration is very low.
Right.
India is starved for a variety of financial products. So that market scalability is not an issue.
Mm-hmm.
But is that transformation in the ecosystem that has happened because of the virus and the opportunities that digital present, is it actually possible to grow much, much, much more faster than what is generally envisaged? So I put a number like 10x in 3 years, but whatever is a very high growth rate.
Okay. Yeah. So, definitely, you know, there is going to be a new normal post this lockdown is over. If we are looking at, you know, any sphere of business, any sector, any geography, it is going to completely change now post this lockdown. And looking at new normal, there are going to be a lot of changes in the ecosystem. And as mentioned, digitally, a lot of we will be seeing a lot of increments going to incremental consumers being onboarded. As I mentioned earlier, there are around 300% jump which we have seen in the customers registration in just 1.5 months time. So going forward, this is going to play a major role. And in banking specifically, if we look at already that digital revolution has started 2 years back. Almost two and a half years back, 3 years. In 2017, when the UPIs, the Aadhaar-enabled payment systems, and all these got introduced into the banking sector, it is really changing, and it is going to completely change in the days to come because of this current lockdown situation, as well as what we are seeing. The biggest platform which is taking shape is going to be the acquisition side on the QR based solutions. If we are looking at customers making payments, they are going to use more of a QR based solutions rather than just, you know, because it is going to be their customers don't even want to give their card for making payment, because then again it's going to be a touch based transactions, right? So there's a technology which is called NFC, that is near field communication. That is going to take a lot of jump in the business, and contactless payments is something which I see is something which is picking up, and it's going to see a major jump in overall consumers accepting those kind of products. And if you look at issuing side, there are, you know, a lot of challenges because in India, if you look at, you know, acceptance side, there is no such kind of infrastructure which is available. If you look at ATMs, the number of ATMs are getting, you know, decreasing. If you look at in the recent scenarios, so around 2.25 lakh of ATMs are only there. But that's the reason it is going to really push a lot of, you know, digital payments. And on the POS terminal sites, if you look at acceptance, there is a lot of development, a lot of infrastructure which is need to be, evaluated and, you know, brought to the system for accepting the payments. Micro ATMs, definitely, it is playing a major role because of, introduction of Aadhaar and all the KYC documents, all the Aadhaar-enabled payment systems. You know, they are also playing a major role. So definitely, the evolution has started in digital platforms. And because of this COVID-19, this is going to take, you know, maybe 10x or exponential. Yeah.
Okay. So essentially, payments are going to jump.
Absolutely.
And within payments, the QR payments are going to lead the revolution.
Absolutely.
Is our understanding. Cool. Absolutely. That's great.
Yeah.
Anuj, if I may come to you. Because of this economic crisis, the demand for credit is going to grow, take a big jump, obviously. And of course, there will be different risk factors to look at. So it may not be possible for lenders to automatically tap into all the credit requirements that are going to come up. But given this opportunity, what do you see as a digital roadmap for you grow and for the NBFC sector in general?
So, you know, they say the most powerful thing in the world is an idea whose time has come. And I think this digital transformation thing is an idea now whose time has come. It's a very, very powerful force. And I'll talk about SME business in general. As a participant in this digital transformation, and it is incumbent on us, if we are sincere, and the potential is huge. I mean, you talked about 10x, it might be 100x. But it is very important for us to understand the other levers in the ecosystem which are required. It is not enough for a customer only to do the financial transaction digitally. It is also important that his other businesses are also digitally enabled. And then only this multiplier effect will come in. And I'll give you a small example in our supply chain business. If I have a customer whom I want to serve digitally, and there is a supply chain where there is his supplier and his buyers who are not digitally enabled at this point in time, then whatever we try, it will not have that multiplier effect. So as a financier, as a incumbent of this new digital world, it is very important for us to also strategize to look and not to to help the other partners of the customer help digitize. And that is not a cost. It is an investment which will give you hefty multipliers in years to come. So that has been our approach overall. The idea is to make his overall business model more digital rather than focusing. Of course, it is important that the financial transaction which we are initiating has to be seamless and should satisfy him. But only that is not enough today. His other partners also have to, we have to help them come on board in this whole new digital ecosystem. So that is what our thought process is.
That's interesting. So if in a one-line summary, all friction points where digital could make a difference needs to be removed through digital kind of solutions.
Yes. Right.
Now, let me come to our last question. So we have an insurance company, we have a bank, and we have an NBFC, and all three have digital strategies. And all three are actually partners in serving the financial needs of customers. But my question is this, do you see some kind of alignment or collaboration between your strategies where you can multiply each other's effectiveness and efficiency.
So while we look at different financial sectors, be it insurance, be it NBFC or banking sector, technology is playing a very big role. And with the recent developments, in times in hand, there are so many fintech companies who have evolved and they have actually brought a lot of, innovations into the entire digital banking world. If we look at, recent innovations, there has been applications which has played a big, big role, and it is bringing all the players together, be it, insurance, be it mutual fund, or be it any other banking financial company. Just to name PhonePe, Google Pay, UPI, they are the payment applications, but most of them are being used on a daily basis. And recently, we heard about the WhatsApp banking, which is also going to help and to change the entire payment industry in a big way. Three sectors, if you look at, they are more or less interlinked to a great extent, because the heart or the core at the back end is the technology, which is helping all these sectors to grow. And being a digital banker, or probably looking after the digital channels, we have observed that innovation in digital technologies is helping a lot of us, a lot of banks, a lot of NBFCs and insurance companies to digitize, to reduce the customer efforts, to increase the customer experience. And the more and more you focus on the customer experience with the help of technology, is making business more profitable and more growing business. So there is a definite alignment in all the three sectors, and to bring all the three into one platform, digital and the technical, the innovations are playing a major, major role.
So
and very brief, please.
Yeah, sure. And I mean, there is a live example. We are partnering with Digit in giving our customers a sector-specific insurance cover. So an insurance cover which is relevant to a light engineering workshop versus a nursing home is different. So is it possible for us to package a product which completely fulfills the need of that particular business, and then execute it digitally? Then it will. So these kinds of collaborations have already started happening.
Okay.
And huge demand for this. So
the,
yeah. So the more and we are always looking at partners who have similar digital mindset like ours, and who wants to approach it. And initially there would be obstacles, because there is an adoption problem, there is a technology related capability issues, but once you keep conquering them, the playground becomes bigger and bigger. So today we are trying to offer to our customers not only a customized loan, over and above that a customized insurance cover through our partner Digit, which completely meets that particular business need.
Okay, that's interesting. And it's interesting that both of you are here from this. So Vivek, what is your take on this partnership and other similar partnerships?
So what Anuj said, that like we are working with Ugrow. Each of us bring certain expertise and certain things that we can do. While customer is looking for a loan or a lending, or in case of a bank, the customer is looking for his savings or for a capital appreciation. But what insurance does is to protect if the plans, if something happens which is not as planned. So there is a lot of synergies which are there, and actually we are working with a lot of banks also for that. What happens is banks become important, lending companies become important, because they are already reaching out to the SMEs, especially SMEs, where the penetration of insurance in India is one of the lowest. And without the partners, reaching out to that segment is very difficult. So for insurance also, that becomes a very good partnership, and for other players also, because the complementary bouquet of products can be offered to the customer. Other thing that happens is that the customer journey remains pretty similar. So if customer is coming to Ugrow, the customer is already familiar with Ugrow. In that scenario, he does not have to switch between different partners, different companies, different platforms to fulfill different needs. At one platform, he is able to get his all the needs, including insurance, available. Same thing happens with banks also. You go to a bank, you already are familiar with how the net banking works or how the platform works or how the branch works. And then when you partner with a bank for an insurance or any other product also, the customer is able to get the same product when he is buying with the same partner. Other thing that happens is whatever trust concerns that the person may have is also not there, because he has an existing relationship with his existing partner, and there the product is also offered by an existing partner. So trust, apprehension, any inconveniences switching to a different platform, learning a different process. The platform already has a lot of details about the customer, so even the things that the customer needs to share becomes quite less. The platform already have the KYC done, so there the lot of informations are not required. So there is a lot of synergies there, and we are working with Ugrow, we are working with a lot of banks also. The idea is to basically work with these synergies. The thing that is required is that all the when you partner with any partner, all the front end and back end needs to work smoothly and frictionless, and technology plays a lot of role there.
So was it smooth and frictionless in the first few weeks or months, or?
No, it takes a lot of effort. It takes a lot of effort initially, but once it stabilizes, then it can work wonders.
So great, thank you, gentlemen. We can, from my side, this is good. Got answers to all the major questions we thought we'd cover. Of course, there's a lot more to cover. And Banking Frontiers will come back and interview more people to get different perspectives.
Thanks, yeah. Manoj. Thanks for this.
Yeah, thank you.
Anuj,
thank
nice e-meeting.
Yeah, same here. Thank you, Manoj. It was a very pleasurable meeting. Thank you.
Yes. We'll all go back.
Thank you.
Thank you.